So good evening and welcome to the 23rd lecture of IPA 50 webinar series, New Horizons in Physics. Today's lecture will be given by, I think my screen is not shared. One sec, let me share my screen. Is the screen visible now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry for that. So good evening and welcome to the 23rd lecture of IPA 50 webinar series, New Horizons in Physics. Today we have Professor Gautam Menon, who will talk about topic something which is very close to everyone's heart today, understanding COVID-19 in India. And to conduct today's lecture and introduce today's speaker, we have Professor Tanushree Sahadas Gupta. She is a senior professor at S.N. Bose Institute, Kolkata, and presently vice president of Indian Physics Association. She works and specializes in the area of electronic structure correlations and computational material science. She has a very distinguished career with many awards, and she's fellow of all national academies, TOAS and APS. I wouldn't go into further details, and without further ado, I would invite her to introduce today's speaker. Over to you, Tanushree.
Thank you, Vandana. It's a pleasure for me to...
Tanushree, you need to be a little loud.
Is it better now?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Vandana. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Professor Gautam Menon to this audience. I think with this television and media hype on COVID and some topic which is now pertinent to almost everybody, I think the name Gautam Menon has become more and more familiar to the audience, and not only inside India, also outside India. And he is perhaps among the very few, and perhaps probably the only one, if I'm not mistaken, who is professor of both physics and biology in an university. So Professor Menon is right now the professor of physics and biology in Ashoka University. And he started his career as a physicist, like many of us. And he did his PhD from Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, where his topic of thesis was very different from what he is doing today. That was to do with the vortex physics of the superconductors. And after that, he had for 2 years stay as visiting fellow in TIFR. And then he was a postdoc in Simon University in Vancouver in Canada. And since then, he returned to India and became faculty in Institute of Mathematical Sciences in Chennai, where he has spent really quite significant amount of time. And if I'm not mistaken, he was also there responsible for introducing the biological unit in this math science. And he has been, his work has been recognized in terms of many distinctions, which includes the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, DAE Outstanding Research Investigator Award. He was also APS Outstanding Referee, and which is actually a very, very big distinction, knowing the high standard of APS. And he became the fellow of National Academy of Sciences India in 2019. And currently he is a professor in Ashoka University. He is also an adjunct professor in TIFR. And his current interest is basically on biophysical problems and modeling of infectious disease, and which has become very, very pertinent in the context of the COVID. And specifically the mathematical and computational model to understand, which is the topic of his lecture today, in understanding COVID-19 spread in India, is a very timely and very important topic and very important contribution. And understanding how good models can inform public policy, which I think is of importance even to government. So with that, I am very happy to welcome once again Gautam, who is also a very good friend of mine. And I'm looking forward to his seminar. Gautam.
Thank you so much, Tanushit, for that very nice introduction. It's a great honor to be giving the IPA 50 lecture this year. And you may wonder what physics has to do with the topic of my lecture. I hope that will become a little clear as we go along. So let me just begin by sharing my screen. Okay, can I, are you all seeing my slides?
Yes.
Okay, so I want to tell you a little bit about understanding COVID-19 in India. And the word understanding is a bit strong. So to be, I think the right way of thinking is thinking about COVID-19 in India and what could be happening. And the way I want to structure this talk is to give you a little bit of background about infectious diseases as such. And partly this is because I imagine that a good number of you will be people without a background in thinking about these problems. I just want to tell you about the minimum terminology or ideas that you might need to think about what I'm going to tell you in this talk. Then I'll spend most of the talk talking about COVID-19 in India, to give you numbers, types of behavior, what we know, what we don't know, etc. I'll talk a little bit about models for COVID-19 spread and how they can be used, as Tanushi mentioned, for public policy, which is an interest of mine. I'll talk a bit about where we are with vaccines at the moment. Then in the future, what to expect, what speculations one might have about what's happening to COVID-19. I might say a little bit about what India did right and what, in my opinion, it did wrong in this country. There's a bit of sound at the back, and just can everybody just mute? So I'm getting a feedback in my. Yeah. So infectious diseases are caused by some microorganism, a bacterium, a virus, a parasite, a fungus. And this bald statement that we all take for granted, it's interesting that it really came after many centuries of people thinking about this particular problem. And this is the germ theory of disease. And it's a very fundamental way about which we think now about infectious diseases, that they have multiple causes, but really they can all be traced back to some microorganism at the root of it. The particular microorganism that causes COVID-19 is a virus. It's called the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And bacteria and viruses is the two major examples of microorganisms that cause disease in human beings. They move between humans directly or indirectly. So direct contact between, for example, shaking someone's hand is one way of transferring bacteria from one person to another. Indirect contact, for example, touching a doorknob and then someone coming by and touching it later is an example of an indirect, of being able to transfer a virus or a bacterium to somebody else through an indirect contact. Droplets, which really is the route that COVID-19 takes, is when you sneeze, your sneeze emits mucus containing particles of virus, and someone walking by or standing next to you can ingest those droplets. And if the droplets are small enough, they remain suspended in the air for a long time. And this is airborne transmission, because this can be delayed. If you're in a lift, you sneeze, you happen to be infected with COVID-19. The remnants of those droplets will stay suspended in the air for quite a while, maybe a few hours. And someone else coming into that lift, not wearing a mask, might be able to ingest that. So COVID-19 propagate between people by a respiratory route. Some diseases are special. They come to us from animals. For example, diseases like smallpox or polio really are diseases that move between human beings. But there is a special category of diseases called zoonotic diseases, whose primary hosts or natural hosts are animals. Bats are a very common natural host. Poultry is another type of natural host. And zoonotic diseases are particularly important, because what happens when a virus or bacterium leaves a natural host and moves over into human beings, this is called a spillover event. And a number of diseases, of infectious diseases of importance in this particular century, SARS, MERS, and COVID-19, are all examples of diseases that came to us from human beings, from animals. This is particularly interesting because 3 out of every 4 new diseases, new or emerging infectious diseases, that is diseases to which human beings have not been exposed before, come from animals. And that's why it's important to think about the larger context of diseases in terms of ecology and looking, sort of trying to integrate human health, veterinary health, the health of the environment, the health of plants, etc., together is called a One Health approach. And this is something that is particularly important to think about diseases and how we might avoid a situation like COVID-19 in the future. It's not just worrying about the health of human beings. You have to worry about the health of human beings as they relate to other parts of their environment. And it's important to understand the close relationship between humans and their environment, which you tend to forget about because we sort of largely intent on despoiling the earth as we see it. A little bit of history about diseases. So influenza is a disease that is a viral disease. And it was responsible, a type of influenza was responsible for, in a sense, the sort of most major or the largest pandemic that the world has seen in the last 100 or 200 years. And that was a pandemic that swept the world between January of 1918 and December of 1919. This is called the Spanish flu pandemic. That's an example of a ward with lots of people, flu sufferers. And you can look at the scale of this. This infected about 500 million people, roughly 25% of the world's population during that period between 1918 and 1919. And this is important because that was a time when the world was just emerging from a world war, from the First World War. And already, you know, there were situations where young men had fought in trenches for about 4 years or 5 years. It was a devastating war for a large fraction of the world. The nutrition had suffered. So you had large populations which had suffered because supply lines were severely restricted. So they were managing on relatively small amounts of food, not a particularly broad cross section. So nutritionally, they were also starved. Between 30 and 50 million people died. And we don't quite know this amount, but it's important to note that about a large fraction, probably the largest fraction of people who died in a country died in India. And 15 to 20 million is one good guess for how many people died in India. And that relative to our population at that time, so about 5 to 10% of our population, which is a huge number. That's one in 10 people. Gandhiji contacted the Spanish flu, and both his daughter-in-law and her young son died of Spanish flu. And the writer Nirala Suryakanta Patil lost his wife and several members of his family to the flu. And he writes, "My family disappeared in the blink of an eye. All our sharecroppers and laborers died, the four who worked for my cousin as well as the two who worked for me. My cousin's eldest son was 15 years old, my young daughter a year old. In whichever direction I turned, I saw darkness." So that's the impact that a pandemic can have at this scale. Just to look only at this century, remember that Spanish flu came from the last century, that pretty much early in the last century, but from 2000 onwards, there was SARS, which we know between 2002 and 2003, H1N1, which is related to the old Spanish flu, 2009, MERS, sort of ongoing, really concentrated around Saudi Arabia, Ebola spread across the multiple years, but 2018, 2019 were years where we did see a flare up. And of course, COVID-19, and the arrow that I have drawn keeps going on, suggesting that diseases are going to keep, they're a sort of given of mankind. I mean, some, even though COVID-19 may subside, something else will take its place in maybe 2 decades, 3 decades. And it's important to understand COVID-19 well enough. And because we now understand the implications of a pandemic disease across the world, so we need to be better prepared the next time something like this might happen. Just again, back to background about COVID-19. COVID-19 is caused by a coronavirus, which is a SARS-CoV-2 virus. This disease originated in China, in the province of Wuhan. It spread in the city of Wuhan. It's now spread worldwide. There are about 220 countries, pretty much all the countries of the world have reported at least one case of COVID-19. The disease is untreatable. All you can do, all a doctor can do, is to provide supportive treatment to someone affected by it. And it spreads through a respiratory route, which is why masks and mask wearing is particularly important. And avoiding being together in a confined space with lots of people, one or more of whom may be carrying the virus, is also important. Most people will recover from COVID-19. In fact, it's interesting that some may not even know that they were ill, or they may just experience symptoms very transiently. And this is, again, unusual because it points to the role of asymptomatic carriers of infection. You may have no symptoms at all, yet you may be able to transfer the infection to somebody else. This is not too uncommon in a larger context, but what is probably uncommon is a very large percentage of people who may be truly asymptomatic. And guesses are that maybe 70 to 80% at the outer limit may be people who will show either no or very, very few symptoms at all. We know now that older people are more predisposed to some adverse disease outcomes. And if you have some pre-existing condition, for example, diabetes or cardiovascular disease, it's more likely that something that you will go down a path that tends towards more severe disease and towards more mild disease. So let's just look at some numbers. And these are numbers for the daily new confirmed cases. And this is the sort of number that one concentrated on, especially in earlier months, when we said, when we sort of looked at these curves for India, you know, gradually go up every day. So the big curve that you see right at the top is actually the result of three peaks, an initial peak, a second larger peak, and really sort of a little wiggle, but basically that's just one third peak. And that's the United States, which currently is reporting more cases than anywhere else in the world. The single peak that went up and came down, and for a brief while, actually had more cases per day than any other country in the world before it was overtaken again by the United States, that's us. Brazil, the United Kingdom, Mexico, all of these are countries that are reporting fairly large numbers of infections. Some of them are going slightly upwards, some of them are on the way downwards, some of them are more or less static. But the Indian curve is a bit unusual. It seems to have had just one peak and then declined from there. What I want to point out is that this is not the real number. These are only cases, that is to say cases confirmed because they have been tested as being positive for COVID-19. But the real number must include all of those people who have not been tested and may never be tested, for whom this was a transient experience because they were asymptomatic for the disease and had no particular reason to go to hospital to be tested for it. So that's unpacking the Indian curve as a function of time, 22nd March, 11th May, 30th June, October. So the peak in this curve is roughly around the 15th of September, the 13th to 15th of September. And after that, you can see that it pretty much went down with maybe a little sort of wiggle during post the festival season in North India, but otherwise really it's sort of coming down on pretty much. And the peak value was a little below 98,000 new cases per day. This is what our numbers look like now. And this is a map of India. And the dark shades are for the larger number of current active cases. So you can see Maharashtra, and then you can see Kerala being fairly dark, Bengal being a sort of little lighter in shade in that particular curve. And the rest of India pretty much is reporting less than 2,000 or, you know, between 2,000 and 5,000 active cases at a particular time. And this is now, we're on the tail end of this curve. So I think yesterday the cases went up by about 12,000, 13,000. And that's the number you should contrast to 98,000 new cases at the peak of this curve. If you look at it in terms of states, and you look at, again, Maharashtra, as I said, tops the cases with the total number of cases, with about 2 million cases, Kerala close to 1 million, followed by Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, mostly states of the south and the center of India. Then, of course, then you have Delhi and UP following after that. The larger number of deaths has been really Maharashtra, with about a case fatality ratio, the number of cases which have then, number of diagnosed cases which have led to death at about 2.5%. The Kerala number is small at about 0.4%, even though they've had a large number of cases, roughly about half of Maharashtra's cases. The shape of this curve is interesting. And, you know, when we think about possibilities of second waves, third waves, et cetera, all of the things that could possibly happen when you think about a disease, look at the curve on the left, which is the India curve, and the curve on the right, which is the US curve, both currently. And you can see the peak for the US, the second peak, and then the third peak again. And really not much of a decline in between these. So you can see that even after the first peak declined, it declined to maybe about 80% of its value at the peak. And then it rose up again. And then after the second decline was pretty much, you know, again, 60% of the peak. And now the third has outstripped the heights or the peaks of the first two peaks in this, the first two waves of COVID-19. But the Indian data don't seem to show that at all. How much are we testing for COVID-19? And this is important because if you don't test at all, of course, there are no cases to be had at all. And this is really what determines how many cases you will pick up, apart from those who are very obviously symptomatic and people who turn up at hospitals in order to be tested. So the larger the ratio of the number of tests that you do to the number of cases that you're picking up, the better it is, because the more extensively you're able to test for people in the population who might be carrying this disease. So at the peak of our testing, we were testing roughly about 1.5 million people a day, which is a very good number. Now we seem to be declining slightly. So we're probably at a little bit less than 0.8 million. And in a sense, we should keep it up. But that also reflects the fact that most of India cases have begun to come down. So it's not felt that there's a need to test at those high levels anymore. I think that's a mistake, but that's what we have at the moment. The most important thing about testing is, and what it really tells you about the progress of the disease, is how many people are testing positive each day out of the tests that you're actually doing. The World Health Organization suggests that number should be less than 5% for you to say that you've been able to exert some control over the disease. Currently, all over India, that number is more like 2 to 3%. So you can see that it went up to a maximum of 12, and then it came down kind of with a little wiggle in between. But now, consistent with the decline in cases, you're finding fewer and fewer positive cases when you test. So typically 2% is a number that is shown here who turn out positive on testing. Look at Maharashtra here, and this is the Maharashtra number. Again, a sort of single peak, and it's sort of the daily positive cases now is somewhere a little less than 5,000. Daily tests went up a little bit and are still sort of probably went down and then have saturated at that value. And positivity is hovering around 5%. It's really hovering around a little more than 5%, which is a little above what it should be according to the WHO. If you look at Kerala, it's a different story because the Kerala cases are still being reported in large numbers. So Kerala is a worry in terms of number of new cases per day. The daily testing is large in Kerala, hasn't come down very much, but the test positivity, which is the number that you should really look out for, is a little less than 10%. And that's worrying because it says there's lots of infections that you're not able to catch. There's a good fraction, one out of every 10 people or one out of every 10 people is positive for COVID-19 among those that you're testing. So there may be a mismatch between the number of cases you're able to pick up and the number of cases that are actually out there. Here's one central and important question that we should ask. How many Indians have had COVID-19 so far? And this turns out to be very hard to answer. And the way this is done is through something called a serological survey. What you do is to take serum samples, that is blood samples from the population of interest. You could do this in Bombay, you could do it across the country in some suitably defined statistical way. And you look for the presence of antibodies that suggest that your body has mounted an immune response against a viral infection, in particular SARS-CoV-2. And this is an indicative of some past infection. So it really answers your question of how have you been infected by COVID-19 so far? Depends on multiple things. The sensitivity with which you detect a past infection depends upon properties of the test, how sensitive is your test in picking up someone who's infected, as well as the rate at which the antibodies that the body mounts to this infection, that the body creates against this infection, that also declines in time. So you have to be able to show that you catch it before it has declined too much. So it's a combination of these two different things that determine whether you can accurately detect a past infection or not. The most extensive India-wide sero surveys come from the Indian Council for Medical Research, or the ICMR. And they did three sero surveys, one across May and June of 2020, one August and September in 2020, one very recently between December 2020 and January of 2021. And the seroprevalence is the word that is used to describe the number of people in their population who turned out to be positive for COVID-19. So that number went from 0.73%, it jumped to a number about 10 times larger, 7.1. But currently the number is about 21.5%. And between Jan 8th and now, it may not have changed very much. Maybe it's about 22 to 23%. But that is a sort of surprising number because it's surprisingly smaller than people had estimated it to be. These are very large surveys. So this is 28,000 people across the country, 70 districts chosen at random. This number excludes urban hotspots where the seroprevalence is known to be large, and I'll come to that. But this, in a sense, is a snapshot of, roughly speaking, parts of India that are not too crowded and really dominated by rural areas. There have been a bunch of other sero surveys all before this, pre-September 2020. So just look at the numbers there. Delhi in round one found 23.5, in round two in August found 29.1. And already at 29.1, it's much more than the analogous number for the second sero survey, which was done about that time. Mumbai had a number like 57.8 in the slum. So this is the survey that TIFR was involved in. Ahmedabad 17.6, Chennai 21.5. And all of this is July of last year. So between then and now, we've had something like 5 months or 6 months in which for infections to build up further. So one could say that some sort of lower bound for this number ought to be in these cities, around 20% is what one would think. There have been even more recent surveys. So the Mumbai Sero Survey in June, July 2020 found 54.1 in slums and 16 in non-slums. The Mumbai Diabetes Foundation in October 2020 found 75% people positive in slums. The second Mumbai Sero Survey, again, which TIFR was involved in, found 45% of samples in slums and 18%. And the decay between 54.1 and 45% is probably because the prevalence of antibodies in the system of the people who were tested may have come down between these two sero surveys. The past infection, the memory of the past infection as registered in terms of antibodies would have come down. Delhi's very recent sero survey in Jan of this year said that over 56% of people have antibodies. So one in two people in Delhi have been infected by, according to this, have been infected by COVID-19. So let's come back to the ICMR report. So ICMR says, if you argue from this, still about 80% of the country is still vulnerable to COVID-19 because their number is around 20% seroprevalence. It's more in the slums. So their number for the slums was about 31.7% for urban slums. For non-urban slums, it went to 26.2%. For rural areas, it was 19%. So you see this gradient between the urban regions and the non-urban regions. And in general, whenever you have people in crowded environments, which you would expect either in an urban slum or non-urban slum, the seropositivity turns out to be high in them. Not much distinction between men and women in terms of how they were infected. Women, in fact, a little more than men seems to be the case. Not much distinction in terms of age. And they also looked specifically at healthcare workers and found that healthcare workers had seropositivity that was somewhat closer to the urban slum numbers, suggesting that they were at a little more risk of contacting the infection than other people. So you can see where the confusion arises. You have numbers for Bombay, numbers for Delhi that seem to be around the 50% range. But then you have an ICMR number that looks as India-wide is about 20%. And in their urban slum calculation, they had 30%, which is nowhere near 50%. And is there really such a sharp gradient between urban and rural India, given that people travel, people move around? And of course, whenever you have a gradient in physics, you sort of assume that there'd be something that will even that gradient out given long enough time, just like diffusion. So can such a gradient last in the first place? So now let me tell you a little bit about models that we've been working on for COVID-19. And this is because you're a sort of physics audience largely. So you will be interested in how person with a background in physics or thinking about quantitatively about physical systems might think about approaching problems like this. So this taps into a large literature in applied mathematics and epidemiology that is devoted to models. And what people who work in quantitative areas who think about modeling do is to figure out different types of models, different types of approximation that can actually be made, building upon this huge body of work that existed before. So I'll tell you a little bit about how one thinks about disease, just to describe what models of disease actually do. And always we're going to think about disease in some population of individuals. We know that individuals are different, and I'm different from you, I'm different from my parents or your parents, etc. But when we talk about disease, the usual simplification is to say that there are a limited set of categories in which we can place people. People can be susceptible to the disease, they can be infected with the disease, or they can be recovered from the disease. So these three letters, S, I, and R, susceptible, infected, and recovered, was called the SIR model, because you say you're going to put people into little boxes based only upon their infection status. So susceptible is not exposed, not infected. Infectious is can transmit infection and is sort of currently infected with the disease. And recovered is has recovered from the infection and presumably will not contact it in the near future. So as I said, now the idea is to place people into different boxes. A susceptible box called a compartment, an infected box, and a recovered box. And to keep track of the numbers within these boxes and look at how people might move between these boxes. Making someone infected is equivalent to taking them from the susceptible compartment and moving them to the infected compartment. When they recover, they move from the infected compartment to the recovered compartment. And then the modeling really is concerned with how do I describe the difference in these numbers? How does the number of S's change, the number of I's change, the number of R's change? And I write down mathematical equations for that. And that answers, at a fundamental level, the sort of most basic questions that I might ask. How many people do I expect to be coming into hospitals because of an infection at a particular time, say, let us say 3 months after the start of the epidemic? These are what those simplest versions of the SIR model equations look like. These are nonlinear coupled ordinary differential equations, three of them. This is what the results of those equations for S, I, and R look like. These equations have one essential parameter, which is called a basic reproductive ratio. And I'll tell you what the interpretation of that is. But you can just see from these equations that it's only the beta by gamma that should be important at all. And from there, I can get to a description of the course of the infection in terms of the peak in the eye and the subsequent decline of the numbers infected. So the theory just says that if you have a disease that propagates in a population, it will rise to a maximum and then it will decay at a long time until finally the disease is eradicated from the population. The reproductive ratio answers a very specific and important question. And the question that it answers is, for each sick person, how many people will they infect on average before they themselves recover? And you can, here are some examples. For Ebola, typically a person with Ebola will will infect two susceptible people around them before they recover or die, more likely. The HIV, the number is 4, smallpox, the number is 7, measles, the number is 18. So measles is highly contagious. If you take one child with measles, put them in a classroom where everybody else is susceptible to measles, that child is going to infect pretty much everyone in the classroom before very long. And this sort of tells you how easily a disease passes from person to person. Therefore, it'll tell you, first of all, how fast that infected curve will rise and what is the maximum to which that curve will actually rise. And that's the interpretation of that parameter in the equation that I told you. The number for COVID-19 is still being argued about, but it's somewhere between 2 and 4, probably closer to 2.5 or 3 than a very large number. And we still may not have much, you know, a very precise handle on that. That's also because this is a number that's really useful at the start of the infection, when everybody is susceptible and when people have not begun to modify their behavior. But the ability of someone to infect someone else is a complex consequence of both biology as well as social interactions. If everyone is quarantined, nobody meets anybody else, and therefore the possibility of passing the disease to somebody is substantially reduced. Then the role of the basic reproductive ratio is taken over by something called the effective reproductive ratio, and that is something that one can calculate given the number of cases that one is seeing. COVID-19 is a little more complicated than that simple SIR model, and it's complicated for two reasons. One is we must account for a period in which someone is exposed to the disease, is building up the virus inside them, but still hasn't got to the stage where they're either infectious to other people or they have begun to show symptoms. And the unusual thing about COVID-19 is you can have people who are infectious without showing symptoms and can be infectious to other people even before they show symptoms, even for people who will show symptoms ultimately. Their main period of infectiousness comes a little before they begin to show their symptoms. And this makes it particularly hard to deal with this disease in terms of public health. So let me use what I told you just now to tell you about two simple models for COVID-19 spread. One is a fairly classical epidemiological model that we have worked on, and the other is a network model for testing. Okay, and this is part of the work that I have done. And I'm not, just for the sake of concreteness and to keep it short, I'll just tell you about these two things. So the first part of this, the epidemiological model, is called InSISIM. And this comes from a large group of scientists, which I'm sure many of you are members of, called the Indian Scientist Response to COVID-19. So the Indian Scientist Response to COVID-19, or the ISRC, set up a modeling group inside it. And that modeling group, since roughly about March of last year, has been engaged in developing models for COVID-19 and making public some of its predictions. So right now, there's a lot of it that goes on behind the public sort of face in these 4 or 5 reports that you can actually see. There are a number of people who come and ask us, what is your projection for what might happen now? What is your estimate for these numbers, et cetera? And we will, a new improved version of this model will be put out soon, and sort of something that describes it in much more detail will also be available soon. But the essential descriptions are all there on this particular website. This is a compartmental model. It sort of assumes the same things that the SIR model did. It just has many more compartments. And we've taken some special effort to make sure that the rates in these models, the rate at which you go from S to R, I, for example, or I to R, are benchmarked to what we think is reasonable for India at the moment. It includes demographics. This is a district level model. So the populations of each district, et cetera, are incorporated. It has a possibility of including migration in it, how someone might move from, say, Maharashtra to UP as part of a large scale migration back. You can also do, very importantly, what are called non-pharmaceutical interventions. You can implement lockdowns within this particular modeling scheme. You can implement some approximation for mask wearing. All of these ones are the consequences of isolating and testing people who are positive for COVID-19. And there's also an online tool that is linked from that webpage. So what this model does is to try and codify what might happen to a patient. So someone, let's say they're infected at day 0, they will all pass through some exposed period, which is marked E in that particular figure. But some of them will remain asymptomatic. There is a period in which they will be infectious to other people, which is relatively short, and then they will recover. Someone who is mildly infected carries a mild infection for a while and then recovers. But you can be severely or critically infected. Both involve hospitalization. But if you're critically infected, you might go to an ICU or you might die. And these are the numbers at which all of the rates at which these things happen. The probabilities are all benchmarked against data that we know from the US, from Canada, from China, from Italy, and so on. This is what the model equations look like. They're much more complicated and have more parameters than the earlier SIR model that I described to you. And the picture on top tells you the connections, the links between the different compartments and who can infect who and how these links describe how you can move from one compartment to the other. So that's all of this information is available on the web page. Let me just show you some applications of this. So this is a calculation that we did around the 15th of June for Pune. So the model predicted certain trajectories depending upon what the reproductive ratio was. So for three values of the reproductive ratio, these were the predictions for what would happen, where the peak would come. And here we were looking at critical active cases that required hospitalization. And you can see the start of this is benchmarked to the data that you can see, which is actual data for hospitalization inside Pune. This is on the 14th of November. And by then we had figured out that there should be a band. We believe that there would be a band shown in gray, which would be the band where we expected sort of the bulk of these cases to actually lie. And you can see that it fits this very well. There's a point initially where it moves out of the band. It seems to be diverging, but it turns out that that is also the point where the Pune administration discovered that there were more people admitted to hospital than needed to be admitted to hospital. So they went and requested people to move back home where they could be looked at because they'd be occupying beds that could be useful to other people. So that's when you see the point, the circles jump back into within the band. And you can see that it stays within that band fairly reasonably. And by Jan 2021, this is where the cases have gone. They sort of stayed down. They're on a little outside the band, come back within this band. So you can see the importance of this for any sort of planning. If you can say that, look, with some confidence, we can say that the cases should remain within this band, and we can keep updating this forecast at intervals of about 1 week or 2 weeks, then that enables hospitals to plan, to increase capacity if they require it, or to convert some of that capacity into treating people who come with non-COVID types of diseases. So we also work with all the districts of Karnataka providing week-to-week predictions together with a group at IISc Bangalore and ISI. So this is one example of Mysore and Bangalore urban. There are a bunch of different projections in there. One of them is ours. And you can see that all of these models do reasonably well against the data. But ours is a more detailed one. The others are essentially sort of short-term fits where you can change parameters every 1 week or so. That doesn't happen in our model. We provide somewhat longer-term interpolations. This is what the model predicts or predicted against the data from Mumbai. You can see it sort of goes up, comes down. The structure of all those dots that you see there are the actual numbers of infected or daily infected people that is seen in the data and are fits against this. If you look at Delhi, and by the end of, July, we said that, look, if you open up around the 1st of August, depending upon how much you increase your reproductive ratio, your numbers will be expected to go up. They would sort of go up, down, and depending upon how much they were increased, you would see different types of behavior. That's what the actual data looked like. So Delhi saw three peaks. This is the first peak, the second peak, and a third peak. And that's our fits to what actually happened in that particular situation. So all of these models and pretty much any similar epidemiological model would predict that about 40 to 60% of India has been infected by now. The problem, as I pointed out, is that the data available isn't particularly consistent on this point. So let me just give you one example of that. And this is an example on the same state, which is Karnataka. And here are two sero surveys. One is the CPHS sero survey, which was done between the 15th of June and the 29th of August in 2020. And that concluded that about 46.7% were infected across Karnataka. An alternative sero survey, which is a little later, around the 10th to 16th of September in 2020, by Girdhar Babu and collaborators, found that only about 27.3% had been infected. And this was, or both of these were, I mean, the second one was done pretty much at a district by district level. So you can see what these numbers look like, that Karnataka as a whole would have 27.3, but Ballari would be 43, 40, 36, 35, 34. These are all numbers that are much larger. Many of these are also rural districts. Many of these are larger numbers than we were seeing in the overall India-wide number that we saw from the ICMR sero surveys. So I'll come back to this point that this is a little confusing at the moment. What are the numbers that we should believe and what should we be thinking about this? But let me tell you about the second problem that we were thinking of, and that is about network models for testing. So right now when we test for COVID-19, India uses two tests. One is called a rapid antigen test or RAT, and the other is the RT-PCR test. The RT-PCR is an accurate test, but it takes a little time to give you results for that, typically 24 hours. The rapid antigen test, as the word rapid suggests, is a fast test. Within 15 minutes, you have your result. Currently, we're testing less than 0.1% of our population daily, we're not doing much contact tracing anywhere in India. If at all, it's a little bit is being done in Kerala, but most of India, we're not sort of looking at family members, people who contacted family members, expanding the circle of people who might have come into contact with the COVID, with a COVID positive person, and then try to ask them to come in for testing and test them. That what is really being done is that you are prioritizing people who are symptomatic for the disease, who turn up with a cough, with a fever, etc. And then at most, some of their close contacts, you may ask them to come in to be tested. And what is done is that you typically isolate people who are positive. They don't have to come to hospital anymore. If they can stay at home and isolate themselves, that is usually the preferred way of dealing with it. Now, the two tests, the RAT and the RT-PCR, which I said, is somewhat skewed in India at the moment. So in overall, in India, the ratio is roughly between 40% to 60% across India. But in Bihar, Delhi, UP, et cetera, it's less than 50% PCR test. So here are some, sort of, here's again making that point that the RAT test is an inexpensive test, but it has less accuracy. The RT-PCR test is a costly test, but it has a higher accuracy. So now you can see what the questions are. How much should you be testing? What is your quantum of testing? How should you mix the RAT and RT-PCR tests based on the fact that it's harder to afford the more costly tests because state governments have to finally foot the bill for these things. So there may be some optimal mix of tests that you can suggest. What do you know about the sensitivity of the tests that are currently being used and who to test? How do you decide who to test? So our network model looks a bit like this picture. You have homes where you have people go to work, they come back home, they go to work. And both at home and both at work, they can be infected with the disease. If they're severely infected, they can go to hospital. In the hospital, they can infect healthcare workers. And you think of this as different networks that are tied together. There's a home network, a work network, a hospital network, and all of these change. And as someone becomes positive, they can infect people in the network that they connect to. And that's why it's a network model. And we try to use what we know about network models to try and understand the property, basically ask how does the disease spread through the population and what should I do in terms of testing and isolation to be able to control the spread of this disease. So here's a sort of complicated graph, but it's not that hard to explain. On these two axes, the X and the Y axis is a fraction of the RATs, which can go from zero, which is no RATs at all, only PCR, to one, which is only RATs. On the y-axis, again, it's RAT sensitivity. So we should go from somewhere between 50% to 100%. So the more you go towards 100%, the more sensitive the RAT gets. But typically an RAT test was somewhere between 50 and 70%. And the z-axis is the fraction infected. So if I work, if I have tests that are, let's say 75% sensitive and 50% of them are RATs, I know exactly where they are if I have a certain daily testing rate. So the daily testing rates, we change from 0.1%, 0.2%, 0.3, 0.4, all the way up to 0.8. And you can see the number coming down. This number is the number of people who are infected at the end of the pandemic. So it's an indication of the fact of how many people finally caught the disease. Ideally, you want to push that number down as low as possible. But to do that, you must test more. And as I said, we're at less than 0.1% today. But this suggests that if you really want to suppress it significantly, you should be testing it at least at about 0.5%. So this is the other thing that we can do is if I have a 50% RAT versus a 70% RAT, and I know what the relative cost of the PCR and the RAT test is, I can say my aim is to have a certain number of people, 50% of people who have recovered, as opposed to 70% if I did nothing at all. What is the combination as a function of the fraction of RATs and the RAT sensitivity? What is the amount that I must pay? What's a measure of the cost of my pay? So this is where, again, as I said, policy becomes important. Because then you can decide, I can afford so much. With so much, I need a test that is this good, it has this sensitivity, and I need to be testing at this level. So that would be one slice, a sort of a horizontal slice at a particular cost, affordable cost. And depending upon the cost of the PCR to the RAT, I have different sets of curves that I can use. So as I said, here is something that state governments can use to think about what the consequences of their testing program might be. And this is an example of the fact that modeling helps to understand the different types of trade-offs that are involved. What is the trade-off between the sensitivity of the test, the fraction of the population that you want to test regularly, the mix between RAT and PCRs, the stage of the epidemic when you begin testing, and the cost of these different tests. It's very, very hard just out of sheer thought alone to be able to understand how these five different trade-offs might mix together and how and what determines, and different states may try different things. one state may decide that we want to push the number of people who are infected at the end of it to 40% or 30%. Some other states may say, look, we have a young population. Most of them are not going to be affected by the disease. We're going to stop at 50%. So they can understand these trade-offs with models such as these. Let me tell you a little bit more about vaccinations. Our India's vaccination program began about 2 weeks ago, two and a half weeks ago, on the 16th of January. There are two vaccines that are currently available. One is called Covishield. It's made by the Serum Institute of India in Pune. And the other is Covaxin, which is made by Bharat Biotech International in Hyderabad. Covaxin is produced by Bharat Biotech in collaboration with the ICMR. So this is really an indigenous vaccine completely. But Covishield, that the Serum Institute of India makes, was developed by AstraZeneca and Oxford University together with the SII. Vaccines in the country are going to be distributed in multiple phases. We are right now in phase one, and this phase one will take around 30 million people, okay? And there will be two doses each separated by about 3 weeks, 3 to 4 weeks. The recipients in phase one will be private and government healthcare workers, frontline workers, sanitation workers, defense personnel, and police and paramilitary forces. Basically, anyone who's frontline and likely to come into contact with people who are COVID-19 or between whom disease might spread rapidly because of the physical situations in which they might be, in which they might encounter. Phase two will focus on senior citizens and people with comorbid conditions. So for example, if you have diabetes and your age between about 50 to 60, then that you should be interested in the phase two part of this in being vaccinated at that point. This is the current status of vaccinations across this per million people. You can see that in that Kerala is doing a sort of fairly large number of vaccinations at 7,642 per million. And this is distributed in some way between the states in different colors. And you can see that the bluer you are, the better off you are. So Himachal Pradesh, Kerala, and I think probably Tripura and other states are in comparable situations. Right now, this is the number of people that we have vaccinated. It's 49,459,445, or about close to 5 million people. And this is, if you look at it at doses per 1,000 people, it's 3.62. We've had 8563, what are called adverse effects following immunization. That is people who had anything more than just a mild soreness in a fever, who sort of have to come back to hospital after their immunization. There have been 34 hospitalizations. So most of those didn't involve hospitalization, and 19 deaths. So the question is, how many deaths would you normally expect in a population of people of 500,000 people five million people who you vaccinated? And is, given what you know about the background of deaths in the general population, is that a reasonable number or not? Is what one has to do, one has to analyze. And here, certainly, this is an important thing, that the causality assessment of were these deaths linked to the vaccine or not, that assessment will be made public, says the person who is advising the committee that is charged with looking at adverse events following immunization. So that level of transparency is a very positive thing. And it's important that we see this data so that everybody can be assured that there is nothing wrong with being vaccinated. Okay, the harder questions come when we think about the future and what's going to happen. So let me just point out a few things. So what's on this y-axis is a log scale for the cumulative confirmed COVID-19 deaths per million people. So look, you can see that this splits up into roughly two different parts. One, the top part is the United Kingdom. So look right at the end, because it's cumulative. By the end, you will get an idea of all the people who have died as a fraction of a per million population. So the United Kingdom, United States, Mexico, Brazil, all sit in the sort of top rung at about 1,000 plus deaths per million people. Okay. India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Malaysia, Indonesia all sit in the bottom rung. And they, because this is a log scale, that's actually a fairly significant separation. It's 1/10 as much as the number at the top. So that suggests that people may be getting infected, but there are still fewer deaths that you might expect compared to those countries. And why is this so different has been a question for a while. And one way of thinking about it is there is something potentially that protects people from South Asia overall. What is happening in India? Here, it is a complicated curve that one shows cumulative number of tests, and the line that you see is the test positivity. The positive thing, or the good thing, is that most of the lines are sort of trending downwards. It's only Kerala that seems to be roughly sort of flat, but look at Maharashtra, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, Jammu, Delhi, etc. All of these curves are on their way down. That means that in a sustained manner for the last, let us say, month and a half, 2 months, the numbers of cases are dropping. the number of people testing positive at your levels of testing is going down. Apart from, as I said, Kerala and Maharashtra is also coming down now. These are all positives to think about when we think about COVID-19 in the long term. So let me try and summarize some of these points before I wrap up. That you should notice that cases in India have been consistently going down since mid-September. Okay, there has been no Diwali Puja peak. Many people expected that in situations where people were coming together, they were not very careful about masks, etc. And the festival season in North India, which really falls in November in North India and Bengal, that there would be some peak or some signal of an increased number of cases, increased number of deaths, hospitalization during that period. That doesn't seem to have happened, or if it did, it certainly was not detectable against the general background of cases. The views from several surveys have been very conflicting. I mean, we've seen numbers that are biased towards the cities, which suggest that 45, 50, 55, 60% of people in the cities have already been infected. And however, that doesn't quite jibe with the relatively low number overall that we're seeing from the ICMR Sera survey. It's sort of likely, in my opinion, that in the cities, at these levels of infections, it's going to be increasingly hard to contact an infection, because most people you encounter, if one out of two people in Delhi have already had the infection, then it's very likely that some sort of herd immunity has set in. And you don't expect in these big cities any large outbreaks. There may be small numbers of people, maybe a sort of a family or two, or maybe a small colony or so, but nothing like the sort of numbers that we saw earlier. If the ICMR third set of survey is correct, in essence, there are still many people in India who are still to be infected. If they say, but look, about only about 20 to 22% of the Indian population has been infected so far, that still leaves about 78% of people yet to be infected. So one should argue that there is always risk, which is why vaccinating people is particularly important. Whenever you vaccinate, there is this concern of, is the virus changing at all? And there's been a lot of discussion around new variants from South Africa, from the UK, from Brazil, etc. And the question here is, if you're infected once, are you already protected against a new variant? Is the new variant spreading faster than the old variant? And would the vaccine that you're having now, would it protect you against the new variants that come? Because viruses keep changing as a consequence of evolution. These are all questions that people who work in this area are desperately concerned with. The last few questions had to do with the graphs that I showed you at the end. Is the India population largely protected against severe disease? Because India is, let's face it, a young population compared to the UK, compared to the US, compared to Germany, compared to most of the countries that have suffered large numbers of cases. Is this generalizable to South Asia, including Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Burma, Myanmar, et cetera, et cetera? Or is this argument completely wrong because we're just not counting the number of deaths and the number of cases correctly? Because the last question is, what about a return to normal life? And this is something that all of us have at the top of our minds. And I think there is a case that if you live in a big city, it's a little easier to wear masks and go outside and maybe not mingle at the sort of level that we are accustomed to from 2 years ago or 2.5 years ago. But it's possible to relax a little bit on the fairly rigid constraints that we were in. But it's important to vaccinate. And it's important to keep checking this and to sort of understand what the sero surveys are actually saying. How many people have been infected? How many people are susceptible? Is there something that protects Indians? We can relax our vigilance a little bit. So many of these are questions. So the safest thing to do, sort of precautionary principle, is just to continue to be careful for quite a while. So let me finish up by describing what India did right, in my opinion. And this is, of course, we could argue about this in multiple ways. We did an early lockdown, and there is some weak evidence that the earlier you lock down, the better it is, ultimately, in terms of the number of cases that you have and in terms of the number of deaths that you have. Use of masks, although people complain a lot, especially on social media, that I went out and nobody was wearing a mask, there's still been more or less across India, pretty much wherever I have traveled. Mask wearing has become relatively commonplace, and there have been, even when people are outside, I have seen pretty much 90% compliance with mask wearing in places that I have been to. Rapid tests, as we pointed out in our calculations, the rapid test, even though it was believed that these are just not accurate enough, we're making mistakes by using rapid tests, they're actually not bad, provided you can actually test at a somewhat larger fraction than you're doing currently. The vaccination program in India has had a good start. It started early, and hopefully that's going to change things substantially in the next several months. Public communication overall was good. It came from the top that you had to be serious about COVID-19. And by and large, it was accepted. And of course, the real core of India's success or whatever it did right has been the health workers who took incredible personal risks and worked pretty much around the clock to be able to handle people, to be able to handle the consequences of multiple lockdowns, people with various other types of diseases, people who were severely ill with COVID-19. We did a bunch of things that were wrong. So I said that India did right. I talked about a lockdown, but the implementation of the lockdown, one could ask, could that have been better thought out? And that's certainly something that should have been much better thought out. Overall, the lack of transparency in discussions around India's COVID-19 response, the sort of extreme silos in which government agencies function, is not a positive, because it's important to be transparent in what you do, because you need to maintain public trust. Vaccine nationalism, there are concerns about whether the two vaccines were treated equivalently at a time when one had not fulfilled all of the requirements of the different trials that the other had, whether this could have been an issue where the sort of nationalism associated with an Indian vaccine was important in that particular decision. Overall, government and government agencies have been a little more strident in rejecting criticism that was actually fairly fair and balanced. And that's I think, a mistake. There are, of course, many long-term structural problems whenever we deal. These are old problems that have to do with the structure of our public health system. And I'm glad that the budget at least now seems to be looking at understanding the need for very specific investments, both in public health as well as in research that is targeted towards these problems. So let me just finish. This is my last slide. And this is a statement from a recent paper in the BMJ, which says, a crucial lesson from the COVID-19 pandemic is that an effective response does not rely just on a strong public health system, but also needs a society that is fair and offers all its citizens and residents social and economic security. So you cannot disentangle economic arguments from public health arguments, that in order to be able to respond in a fair manner to the needs of a public health emergency, one must also ensure that the social and economic safety nets that exist are available to everybody and that no one is treated unfairly in that particular context. So let me finish up here. It's pretty much on time, and thank you for your attention. Tanushree, you're muted.
Yeah. So thank you, Gautam. Thank you so much for this really nice overview of this particular topic, which all of us are concerned about. So I see there are some questions from the YouTube. I don't see anything in the Zoom, but I would first like to ask if anybody has any question, who are participating by Zoom?
Ramki has a question.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, Gautam, it's a very nice talk. I really enjoyed it. And of course, you know, it's about the disease and one is worried. There are two things. I think one is just a small remark. Actually, the Spanish flu is not actually Spanish flu. I think the flu existed before that. Only the Spanish guys reported it and its name got stuck, yeah. I think. So historically, I think poor guys. I mean, just in a remark. The second thing is that the multiple peaks you see in the other countries, of course, UK now we know because of the second strain, it has gone up and so on and so forth. And, you know, usually one dreads the second wave. You remember in India, it was reported that it is the second wave in the Spanish flu killed more than the first one and so on. But is there a chance that we will also get into the second wave? Or what is your, you know, I'm just, you know, it's a crystal ball. I'm just saying that what's your impression on this?
So the whole question is that how many people in India are yet to be infected? Okay. If you have a large susceptible population, there is nothing to prevent them from getting infected as far as we know. So that's where the ICMR sero survey results are very important, because they really look at India outside the major cities. Most of the sero surveys so far have been Bombay, Pune, Bangalore, right. Chennai, Kolkata, etc. But this is the one that looks at, you know, some remote districts in the country, 70 of them, and asks what happened there. So everything that we understand from that, sort of the statistical analysis that comes from there, suggests that, you know, 22, 23, maybe 25% of the population has been infected so far. But that still leaves, if you imagine that you will get to herd immunity by 60 to 70%, that still is a good 40% of India's population who is still susceptible. So it's perfectly possible for a second wave to come in, if that is the interpretation.
Okay.
So there's nothing that rules that out from that.
Okay.
Only question is that, is there something that protects Indians? So one idea that Shekhar Mande has is that, and Rajiva Karandikar and their collaborator, is that something is called the hygiene hypothesis might work here. And that is, okay. Indians are already exposed to so many pathogens in their environment. You know, we sort of live in highly polluted, dirty environments, that our immune systems have evolved to be able to deal with things like COVID-19 a little better. So we may be either very mildly infected or maybe not even infected at all. Nobody really knows. But that's one suspicion that maybe us Indians, as well as some part of South Asia, has, because of the circumstances in which we live in, may just be better protected. Now, that this is something that has to be examined, and one has to look at this and see if this is true or not. But it's certainly a hypothesis.
There is another angle. You know, unlike other virus like Ebola, who kills the host, you know, and ultimately it kills the host. Whereas these COVID ones are very tricky in a sense that they can even coexist with the host, right? So then this is going to be a much longer term effect than, you know, what one would like to think, that, you know, we would get back to normal. I don't know, you know, it would be a prolonged thing as compared to deadly things like Ebola.
So that is one hypothesis, that this will become a sort of regular seasonal
right, flu.
And like the flu, which keeps coming and going and sort of changes in various forms. So maybe every 2 years or 3 years, you might have to have a booster shot of a vaccine. So we might have to move to a situation like that, where this becomes, in a sense, endemic. It's not wiped out altogether. But that's certainly things that that's something that many people believe will be the case.
Thank you. Thank you, Tanishree. Thank you, Gautam.
Thank you. I see one comment from the Zoom audience, which is posted in the chat box. And the question is, why has the MERS infection stayed confined in South Asia?
So MERS is sort of largely in Saudi Arabia and a few countries surrounding it. But there was a point where it moved to Korea. There was a cluster of cases in South Korea around 2015. And MERS, actually, the difference between MERS and COVID-19 is that MERS kills you 30% of the time if you catch it. It has a very high fatality rate. So you don't have much time to go around infecting people, because you fall sick and you die very fast, and by then people know what you've died of, so they can take appropriate precautions. The difficulty, exactly as Professor Ramakrishnan pointed out, is for diseases that don't kill you, that sort of hang around for a while, make you miserable. In some small percentage of time, they kill you, because then it's much more likely that you will be able to pass it on to other people. And that's really the distinction, that MERS has a high fatality rate of about 30%, and it kills you very fast.
I see Vandana has a question. Vandana, can you please, ask the question?
Okay. I mean, this is a small question. See, if you... Okay, let me just mute others. Yeah. So there is no disturbance. So the Maharashtra seems to have a higher death rate. Is it just the reflection of the poor medical record? Medical support? Because if I recall correctly, even for swine flu, the mortality rate in Maharashtra was higher than the national average.
Yeah, I'm hesitant to sort of assign a specific reason without knowing a little more, or without sort of studying this a little more carefully. But I think the reason that Kerala is doing well is for that reason. I think Kerala, in general, public health systems, follow-up, etc., is better. And I think that's where I think Kerala is doing better, because Kerala's number is really quite small compared to the other states. For Maharashtra, the big state, you know, a lot of inhomogeneities. In cities like Pune, somewhat older population, because it's really a city of retirees. Yeah. All of this may have different contributions.
So maybe we can now take up the questions from the YouTube.
Your things are not.
Sorry, Vandana, I didn't hear you.
Yeah. Vandana, you got your voice got cracked.
No, still can't hear you. Still can't hear you.
Vandana, maybe you can.
I'll type it in the chat.
Yeah.
So, in the meanwhile, we can take up the questions from the YouTube. So, there is this question: what is the nature of the network of these infected people that you have presented globally? Is it scale-free?
We don't know, and it's a sort of guess for what, I mean, there's a little bit of information known from studies of social networks that a group has done that sort of tells you what the level of contacts is in school and across different countries. And we may essentially make sort of approximations for that. We know what the typical family size is, so we choose the distribution of family sizes in the simulation that is consistent with that. We sort of assume that workplaces are all roughly the same size, about 30 to 40 people each. These are approximations because we just don't know. And for much of sort of in the future, I sort of hope that we will just collect better data on India, because this is absolutely vital to understanding how diseases spread in India as opposed to Europe or somewhere else, where much of this information is known. So that's a very good question. The networks that we use are not scale free. However, we've looked at a bunch of networks that have some amount of super spreading characteristics and some a little more random than that. So we looked at it and checked to see if the results were more or less consistent across these different networks. Yeah.
Well, the other question or the concern is, this is not a perfect mathematical modeling, because it would require then testing of all the people in the country every day so that you have a complete data set.
No, that's true. But what we do in our model is that we account for a multiplier factor between the number of cases that you detect and the number of cases that should actually be there. And we also say that death counting is probably a little better. It cannot be off by a factor of 100. Cases can be off by a factor of 100, but roughly speaking, you will soon find out if you have 10 times more deaths than you have. So it's a complicated fit. So the model, I didn't describe it in detail, but it has to be consistent with the trajectory of deaths, the consistent with the number of cases and a multiplier factor, as well as everything that we know about the disease, what fraction of patients will die, in what age group, what are the contacts between different age groups. So it's pretty much state of the art as far as modeling exercises are concerned, but you're completely right. If one had a perfect data set where you could actually know what are the different stages, how many people were actually infected asymptomatically, symptomatically, that would be a great help, but we don't know that.
The other question is, in your modeling, do you take into account the impact of the lockdown or adequate mask? For example, can you kind of predict if these two factors were not there, what would have been the number?
Yeah, that we did. In fact, these are all the reports that you can see on the webpage of the ISRC, where we looked at what would happen if, as a consequence of a lockdown for some amount of time. If you combine lockdown with tracing and isolation of people who tested positive, mask wearing is a little approximate, because all of this has to translate into some contacts between people, some effective R, etc. So if there's a way of mapping one to the other, you can do that. We have one way which we use, and that certainly gives you the sort of suppression that you might expect from this. But, and we also, of course, as I said, we put in lockdown. So lockdowns is part of the model. In fact, even on the online tool, you can put in your own lockdown for your own period and see what happens to the numbers of cases.
Mm-hmm.
And vary the time scales over which you can test and so on. So this we do. And so we also did this in the case of, we were asked somewhat early on, what's the best way of going back to work? Would a staggered schedule work? Can I work for 5 days, then take off for 10 days, then work for 5 days? What is the optimal mix of time on and off? Suppose I'm not at work, then I'm properly quarantined or locked down. Yeah. Is that a solution to getting people back to work? So all of these we managed to look at. And to do that, we had to implement a serious approach to lockdowns in the model. Yeah.
There is a question related to vaccines. So I don't know, it doesn't come out of your model, but maybe just the information. What are the adverse effects distributed among the two vaccines? And people are very much concerned which vaccine to take and which vaccine is better. And
We don't really know that, because I think most of our data currently is for Covishield, which is the vaccine that is being made by the Serum Institute. Mm-hmm. And I think we have less specific information about adverse events associated with the other one. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I'm not even sure we have it broken up across vaccines that have currently been distributed. There is, with any vaccination, if all of you will remember being vaccinated as a child, you will have a mild fever for a day, it'll hurt like something. And some of that has to be taken for granted, and you should not overreact to it. The number of adverse events, the number of deaths, does not look particularly to be out of whack at the moment. And there should be part of the normal background, if you sort of look at the, just look at the sort of numbers of people who've been vaccinated, the number of events consequent upon that. But of course, it's important for the regulator to examine every one of them and to make a report saying that, look, we don't think this was related to that. We don't think this was related to that. And if it was related, to find out why it was related. So as it is, I think all of you know that the whole process by which a vaccine is finally approved is a fairly complex process that involves testing at different dose levels, testing on successively larger populations. So already long before it's actually reached people for broad distribution, it's been tested in multiple ways to check for various types of reactions and so on. So I don't, from what I see, I don't think that should be a barrier to any of you getting vaccinated. And I've sort of said so. It doesn't seem as though there is particularly, there is anything that I would personally worry about these vaccines. At a technical level, you may worry a little bit about the fact that the Covishield vaccine has not gone through what are called phase 3 trials. It's currently happening. On the other hand, the company that makes Covishield, which is Bharat Biotech, has a long history of making vaccines for the whole world, for large fractions of the world. And it's also a very standard platform, the one that they're using. So you can decide whether that's a balance of risk that you want to take. But certainly with Covaxin, I have not seen anything personally that would suggest that there was anything to worry about.
I guess there has to be some reaction. Otherwise, you don't know whether the vaccine is there or not.
It's actually interesting because when you test the vaccine, you have to give it to a placebo. You have to give a placebo as well as to actually say, is the vaccine making a difference? Now, the placebo must also elicit that type of reaction. Otherwise, suppose someone injects you with just plain water and nothing happens. So you will know that whereas somebody else who's taken it has developed a rash and has developed a fever. So you must be able to fool everybody equally, which is an interesting thing.
I think there is another question. So how different is this modeling from the modeling of growth and decay rate?
They're all kind of related models because anything that it's all a sort of decay rate from one compartment into another compartment. As I said, S goes to I, it goes to R. So the numbers in S must decay, the numbers in I must build up. But it's the nonlinear connection between the susceptible and the infected compartment that are important here. That's what makes this model a little special. Otherwise, it would just have been a set of linear equations that one would write down. So you don't have an exact solution of this model. It's just that level of complication that makes it hard to write down an exact solution for. So the solution is, but it can be done easily numerically.
So Bandana, of course, couldn't complete her thing, but she has put on chat box. She said that, if I recall correctly, even for swine flu, the mortality rate was higher in Maharashtra than the national average. So is there really a connection? I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, no, that's a good question. I don't know. I mean, again, because a lot of this depends upon how good your public system, health system is at picking up cases. And, you know, you could argue that Kerala is doing badly now on all measures because it's just finding the cases that other people are not looking for at its levels of testing and follow-up. That's certainly possible that what could be happening. So it's a hard question to answer whether there is something intrinsic to the population, intrinsic to the health system, or it's just sort of, you know, not as much testing as in other places, other types of issues that might be connected with this. It's a nice question, but I don't know the answer.
Thank you very much once again, Gautam. I just have one comment or question. So we all have heard that there is a second trend that has come, at least in UK. So in your modeling, is there a way to include that if you have multiple trends, what's going to happen?
Yeah, the sort of, they're called variants in this context. So, I mean, so that's one major worry about what do these new variants do? Does your body recognize this? If you've already been infected with the original variant, does that give you any protection against the second variant? That's certainly one question to ask. If you've been vaccinated using sort of the virus from the first, pieces of the virus from the first, variant, the original virus, does that give you protection against the second one? None of this is very clear yet. What we believe is that the vaccine seemed to work against all of the variants that we know currently, that some level of antibody protection does exist. How much is not very clear. It's all very, very fast evolving. So what I may say now will be out of date by, I think, probably by the middle of next week or something like that. And this is certainly easy to put into the model. And this is something that we've been asked before, and we can certainly do it, and we will be doing it.
Okay, Thank you very much for this really, really informative talk. In fact, there are many posts in the YouTube where people appreciated that it's very informative. Of course, I agree with them. So, Vandana, over to you.
Thank you, Tanushree. Thank you, Gautam, for a really a very nice talk covering, I mean, from the COVID, as very correctly Tanushree said, the marriage of a biology and physics, bringing it out very nicely. So thank you very much. And thank you, Tanushree, for conducting the lecture so nicely. I thank all the audience for joining us in this lecture, and remind you that next Saturday we will meet again at 5 o'clock. We have lecture by Professor Aditi Sendre from HRI, and she will talk on quantum technologies. So see you again next week, and thank you. Stay safe in the meantime. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Thanks, Anushree.